Hello, folks. Welcome to Holding Only and Holder, where I talk to interesting people about interesting topics. My name is Steve Holder, and I am your host. My guest today is Stephanie Green. She's a survivor of sexual abuse, and we're going to hear her story. And also, she's been keeping up with the Summer Wells case and sees many red flags that she wants to share with us. So, welcome, Stephanie. Thanks for being here.
Thank you for the invitation.
Well, you're quite welcome. So just to get us started, tell us basically who you are and why you think you have a story to tell.
Well, I am 45 years old, and I've had a story to tell for quite some time. It actually pushed me into the mental health field, and that brought about a lot of new changes for me. This is not something I would have talked about before to anybody. Because as a child, you're taught to keep things quiet, to not tell things, that secrets are important, and things of that nature. So this will be the first time really speaking out to anybody other than my close friends and family. So, and it was something that I prayed about and I had to think about for a minute. Like I told you before, my family just got over COVID. So we had to wait a few days for that. Yeah. And why do I have a story to tell? I think it's important. I think it's a very important topic that is brushed under a rug a lot of times. It's held in family secrecy so hard that it never gets out. And people are ashamed. You're taught that that secret is a shame on you, yeah. Not the shame on another person, but it's the shame on you. So you don't talk about it because they look at you as being the guilty person or the one doing the bad thing because you're airing all this dirty laundry from your family out into the world. Yeah. And nobody wants that. Yeah. But I think it's important for people to start talking about it a little more and for people to understand that it's not something that keeps you from having a family. It's not something that keeps you from having a relationship. It's not something that you have to bear the weight of all of your life. You can get that secret out there and you can heal from that.
Yeah. I'm glad to hear you say that. That's definitely the way a lot of people feel. And I've had some experiences that, you know, when I was a kid, I really was ashamed of, and I had to learn that it wasn't my fault, you know, just as you've had to learn what happened to you was not your fault.
Right.
So your dad sexually abused you, is that correct?
Yes.
You want to tell us about that?
For years, actually. I think the first time it happened, I was maybe five. And it happened up until I got married when I was 17.
Wow.
Yep. So it was quite a few years. I can't speak for past family because nobody will talk about this with me. This is not a topic that any of my family on that side is interested in even discussing with me.
Yeah.
So do I assume it's a generational curse? Absolutely. Do I have any proof that it's a generational curse? No, I do not. So because I don't think it just comes out of nowhere. I don't think an adult just wakes up one day and decides that this is what they're going to do with their life.
Yeah.
I just don't. I don't think that. I just, right. I can't that way. So the first time that I can remember, I was actually in the bed with my parents laying beside of my mother, and he would reach over my mother and actually touch me inappropriately. There never was any penetration type stuff, but mostly touching, inappropriate touching.
Yeah.
For most of my life, most of my childhood.
Yeah.
So I guess the thing that gets me is you hear people say, well, if your mom would have knew, she would have done something. Or if you would have said something, somebody would have helped you. That's not entirely true. This is something that happened on I would say 4 to 5 nights a week. it was not random. It wasn't because he was on medication or he had an issue. I mean, it was a thought out process that he went through. And like any other predator, he would buy me things. I had a stereo and the other kids didn't. I got knickknacks and the other kids didn't. You know, it was, but I only had brothers. So it was just me and my brothers. So it was one of those things where you realize it's not right when you get old enough to like spend nights with your friends and nobody else has that story.
Yeah.
You know, you don't see anybody else's dad sneaking in their room, or you don't hear about anybody else's dad doing inappropriate things. And you start thinking, maybe that's not right. Maybe that's not how the world is.
Right.
So it took me quite a while to come to terms with the fact that something was wrong, because I was small and I was always told, if you tell anybody, you'll never, ever see your brothers again. And I was the oldest child, so I took care of my
brother. Told you.
Yes, yes.
Okay.
You'll never see your brothers again. You'll never be allowed back in this house again. You'll never be part of a family again. If you do get a new family, then it's going to be worse. It's going to be worse on you. Yeah. So being 6, 7, 8 years old, somebody tells you it's going to be worse in another family. Well, you don't know that it's not.
Exactly. Exactly.
You don't know that it's not going to be worse. So you never speak of it. You act like it never happened. You let the night go away with the night and you never speak of it. Like, you just go on and pretend to be like your friends. You know, you just, you pretend.
Yeah.
It becomes a game of how much can I pretend before I can't pretend anymore.
Yeah. You said you got married when you were 17. Was that mostly to be rid of your father?
He actually signed my marriage license.
Okay.
Because he was threatened by me. I was at an age at this point where I was starting to be vocal about, this is wrong. This is not right. This is not how other dads act. This is not how other families are. This is not, I know this ain't right. And at this point, my sister had been born and she was 4. And he signed my marriage license because, number one, I was getting too vocal and I was getting too out there with it. Number two, I was getting at an age where they were going to start cutting me off of the public assistance. So I was no longer a necessary part of the family because I wasn't going to be bringing in any type of income.
Really?
Yes.
Wow. So your little sister, when I know, I think you said in something I seen you put on a Facebook group that you felt like your little sister might be in danger when you left.
She was only 4, so I thought I had time because it usually didn't start till 5 or 6 around in there.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought he was different with her for some reason, maybe because she was the baby or something. And she actually would come and spend the night with me. I would go get her regularly and keep her for weeks at a time. And she was taking a bath one night and she just kept telling me that she was itching. She was itchy. And that set off a red flag for me. And I asked her where, and I had her show me. And I realized real quickly what was happening. I called social services. I called the police department. I know it hadn't been going on long, and I didn't want her to live through that. So I put a stop to it.
So did Child Protective Services take her out of the home?
Well, that's a good question. I'll back up and tell you about Child Protective Services. They come to our house on a bi-monthly basis, at least.
Yeah.
The home was not fit for children. It was not. We had no running water. We had no toilet. We had no inside toilet. it was filthy. There was dog feces and cat feces everywhere. It was not somewhere a child should live.
Yeah.
But when social services would come, they would just see us as a poor family that needed help. And so they would bring cleaning supplies and food, which I appreciate. But what they don't realize is that after they left, we had to clean because they would come back in 3 days. So we were handed a bunch of cleaning supplies and told, you better get this house cleaner. They're going to take you and they're going to put you in a bad place. They're going to take you to jail.
Yeah.
So we were forced to clean the house. And they seen us with bad teeth. They seen us filthy. They seen us, you know, thin. They seen us not be in the best of shape. And yet they never took us out of the home. I don't know why. I actually had the privilege of talking to the first social worker that ever came to our home and remind her who I was and what case it was that she worked on set for several years. Like, social services come to our house for 4 years straight and never
before they, offered,
they never offered to take us out of the home. Never, not one time. Never tried to get family members to take us, didn't offer us anything. They never took us out of the presence of our parents to ask us questions.
So what happened after you contacted them about your sister? I mean, nothing.
It was a different time then, and I guess social work had changed. And I wouldn't let it go. I called the state police. I called the state police, and then I called DCBS. So that way there would be somebody else involved.
Yeah.
And at that point, they did. They contacted my sister. They did an interview with me because the case hinged on me telling my story because she was only five. And so I had to tell them everything, and I had to tell the cops everything, and I had to, you know, I had to do all those interviews and things like that. And they arrested them and took my brothers out of the house. Finally, I was 20, I believe, and I was 6 months pregnant.
Mm.
And so they did take my sister and my brothers out of the house after 20 years.
Yeah. And your dad was arrested?
He was arrested, and my mother was arrested. She was arrested on neglect charges because of the way that the home had looked and the way the children weren't being taken care of, medical neglect and some other things. My father did get arrested. I did press charges. I did testify against him in open court, and he did pull time in prison.
Good.
Of which he says that I don't understand how bad prison is, and I shouldn't have done that to him.
You shouldn't have done it to him?
Yes.
Wow. So is he out of prison now?
He is. He is, and he is off probation.
Is he in your area?
He is.
Is he a threat to you now?
Oh, no, no.
Good.
Absolutely not. Me nor my sister. Actually, he wouldn't be a threat to anybody at this point because I tell people when I see them, I'm like, don't have your daughters around him. But I honestly, in my opinion, don't think that he would do anything like that to a stranger's child. It was all family oriented.
Did he grow up in that kind of a family?
I can't speak to that because I can't get anybody to talk to me about it.
Yeah, okay. So did your mom tell lies to cover up for him? Did she deny what he was doing or what?
Oh, yeah. When we had court, my mother actually told them that my father slept in pajamas. My father came in right behind her during his testimony and testified that he slept naked. So she done everything in her power to cover for him. She only divorced him because my grandmother told her, if you ever want to see your kids again, you're going to have to divorce him and get away from him. Mm-hmm. Had it not been for that, she would not have divorced him at all. She covered for him the whole entire time.
Yeah. What does she say about it now?
I don't know. I don't speak to her.
Okay. Did your dad abuse your mother also?
She was very mentally and verbally abused. He never physically abused her, but mentally and verbally, he was very abusive. And she was raised in an abusive home when she was a child. So, you know, I guess that plays into it. She was a victim when she got married at 16, and she still stayed the victim through her marriage.
Yeah. So she was traumatized and intimidated also, and she didn't feel like she could do anything.
I believe, you know, I mean, if you're going to go as far as to tell a child that they're going to go to prison or jail if they say anything, I've heard him tell her, nobody else will ever want you. You'll never find anybody. Nobody will love you. You're disgusting. Things of that nature. So, yes, she was very abused and traumatized. She truly was.
That's kind of classic for abusers, isn't it? What you just said, that's the language they use and the tactics they use. Nobody else wants you. I'm the only one that loves you. Crazy stuff like that, right?
Yeah. And over years, I mean, they were married for a long time. So over years of hearing that over and over and being isolated from your family and being isolated from the public and being isolated from other people, I mean, what else is she supposed to believe after that's told to her time after time after time?
Yeah, yeah. So how does long-term abuse and incest affect you mentally and emotionally?
I had a really hard time with relationships. As with anybody who's probably, I'm not a truster of men.
Yeah, I can understand that.
I have four daughters. And I do not trust men around them unless I know them personally, like, and have been around them. My daughters don't go spend nights at their friend's house. We don't do that because of my fear.
Do they understand that?
They do. They're very understanding. They're very understanding. I have a son, and I've always taught him, you know, we don't touch people here. We don't do this. This is inappropriate. Don't, you know, we always have that talk because you have to teach the boys better too.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. Well, let's talk about the Summer Wells case. That's how I met you in a discussion group. Talk about the Summer Wells case. Just in case anybody that don't know, she's a 5-year-old girl that's been missing for more than 2 months without any real leads. There's lots of theories, lots of speculation about what happened to her. And you have a lot of similarities in your story, don't you? A lot of similarities.
Yeah, there is. And see, I'm not too far from where she went missing. So from day one, I seen it on the internet. I seen it on, you know, all these outlets. And I started looking into it, and I didn't really say a whole lot about it because kids go missing. It's a sad state of affairs, but it happens
all the time.
And I didn't interject myself because everybody had this theory and everybody had these thoughts. And I kind of kept mine to myself because when you're an abuse victim, a lot of people say, well, you only think that way because you were abused. That's not true. I've seen kids go missing before, and I'm like, that's tragic. And then I see other instances, and I'm like, oh my goodness, somebody needs to pay attention because nobody's looking at the obvious things.
Yeah.
So I've been watching it, and it's important to me. Like I said, I have four daughters. So things like that are important to me.
Yeah.
Well, and then these pictures started coming out and these statements started coming out and all of these things just didn't make sense. Why are they allowing children in this day and time to live in that kind of environment? If the father is so abusive, why are they allowing them to live there? The mother, however, she just seems to oppressed to me. She just seems like she doesn't have any control over anything in her life. And I feel for her, I do. But things just wasn't adding up. The stories kept changing. The house was filthy, the yard is filthy. And everybody kept telling me, you're poor shaming them. I've seen your Facebook. I know that you're this, 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 and this, and you're poor shaming. And all I could think is you don't know me.
No.
You don't know me at all to even be making that assumption. And I started looking at the fine details. Number one, the dad admitted to abusing his stepsister or his sister.
Yeah.
His son has been in jail for the very thing that the inconsistencies with. He got home first, but he didn't get home before the police. Like, it changes. Everything just kept changing and changing. The look on her face, the helplessness in her eyes, really just made me sad.
So you think Summer has been abused by him?
I would say yes. That's my opinion. Yeah. And there's telltale signs, and I'll tell you what they are.
Okay.
He said, she's never loved me like anyone else. She is a 5-year-old child. He said, she sleeps with us, but sometimes mom don't even come to bed.
Mm.
Her bedroom is near their bedroom.
It is the same room, isn't it, in the basement?
Yes.
Yeah.
But she doesn't sleep in her own bed.
Yeah.
And mom doesn't come to bed. She gets drunk or high and passes out. She doesn't even come to bed. In that case, you shouldn't be sleeping with her.
Yeah.
Pick her up, put her on her own bed, and let her be. She, in her pictures, if you'll look at her pictures, there's certain times where she's dressed really cute. And the statement was, he buys her gifts. That is the first thing that happens. Is you make that child feel special by giving them things that you don't give the other children. She's constantly in her pictures, if you'll go back and look, she's constantly holding herself in her private area.
I have noticed that.
Yeah, she's constantly got her hands on her private areas.
Hmm.
And what happens is a child of sexual abuse will keep yeast infections or be irritated in that area, and they'll constantly hold themselves.
So that's where the itching come in that you mentioned about your sister, right?
Yes.
Okay.
It's a telltale sign. Most little girls, and I say little girls because we're talking about Summer, or, you know, it would be inclusive. But most little girls will hold themselves. I mean, if a child has to pee, it'll grab itself and it'll be, I got to go to the bathroom. But hers is an instinctual, she's constantly holding herself.
Yeah.
And that's the things that people don't see. It's like, oh, look, she's taking a picture. Yeah, but do you see her body language? Do you see how she's standing? She never smiles. Her eyes look pain. She looks like she's distant in her eyes, like she don't even want to be there. And by there, I mean anywhere. And when the only time she seemed to be happy was when she was swimming or when she was playing or at the church with those other people.
Robin, yeah.
And if you'll notice, even when she's at church, she's constantly giving affection to people. That's another thing about sexual abuse victims is you will equate sex to love or touch, an inappropriate touch or an inappropriate amount of affection, like constantly hanging on somebody or constantly touching them, constantly. That's not normal for a child, for someone who is not family or not personally acquainted with them to be indulging in that much affection on a person. And it's just things that you see that other people don't see. Most people go, you know, and everybody was talking about how dirty she was. Well, yeah, she's a kid. I didn't see the dirt. I didn't see the playing in the rain. None of that made a difference to me. It was her demeanor. She always seemed sad. She just always seemed sad in her pictures. And yeah, there's a few videos out there of her laughing and stuff, but they're far and few between all the things that she's not happy in. She just doesn't seem like a happy child to me. And the way that he speaks of her just runs chills up my spine. He talks about her in the past tense now.
Yeah.
That works for me. They talk about them being so poor and them being so without, but yet somewhere in a statement, they paid $800 a month in a car payment or something.
$600, I think. That's still big.
Yeah. Well, and then there's insurance and all that stuff. But if you can afford to pay that in a car payment, you're going to tell me you can't afford to go get a broom and a mop and some cleaning supplies from the dollar store?
Yeah.
Can't do that? You can't do that for your kids? But the sexual abuse part is what gets me. If he's done it this whole time and he's not gotten caught, he's going to get confident that he's never going to get caught.
You think that's just in his nature?
I do. I think it's a systemic thing. Where did his son learn it?
Yeah.
And then the grandmother had some fella living with her that was also a predator. At some point, somebody
Jose,
said.
Jose, is that, I think, something like that.
Something like that. So why are you surrounding your five-year-old and your sons? Because I don't know that they haven't predatorized the little boys either.
Yeah.
But why would you have that around your daughter, your five-year-old daughter? And then people talking about that she's nonverbal. I don't know that she was nonverbal. I've never heard her speak. In any video, I've never heard her speak. If she's nonverbal, why? Why?
So is that a sign of sexual abuse, to be nonverbal?
It can be, because you're afraid you're going to say something that's going to get you in trouble.
Okay.
What if you accidentally say something and then you get in trouble?
Yeah.
And from what I understand, from my limited understanding of the family, the mother is not very good at mothering. I reckon she's pretty hard, especially on Summer. That's another thing that I have a lot of, that I have experience with. My mother was jealous of me. I weighed 85 pounds when I was 14 years old, and she used to tell me that I was fat and that I was ugly, because there was that air of jealousy because I was being sexually abused. She somehow, in her mind, so twisted up, she was jealous of that.
Yeah.
And to hear that that's how this baby was treated, and everybody, well, the people that I've read statements and stuff from say that she was jealous. She was jealous of this little girl. She was jealous of her mother.
Yeah.
How can you be jealous of a five-year-old? How?
Have to be pretty insecure and pretty emotionally disturbed, I suppose.
And see, that's my issue. If she's that jealous of her,
what would she do?
What would she do?
Yeah.
Did she hit her? Did she yell at her? Did she scream at her? Did she lock her in her room?
Yeah.
I mean, what types of things go through my head is, what did she do?
Yeah. So do you think Donald's under the impression he's never going to get caught? I mean, he sounds kind of like he's getting really scared here lately.
I think the only reason he's getting scared is because I really believe he's got people on these message boards reading these comments, and I think people are getting so close to the truth that he's starting to panic just a little.
He's really agitated at Chris McDonald.
I noticed. Yeah. I noticed. Yeah. And I've heard people say that Chris was wrong in how he questioned him, and he was wrong in what he did. How was he wrong?
I assume when he talked to Donald, he told him it was going to be on the air. I mean, I imagine he knew it was going to be broadcasted.
I mean, he would have to. Yeah. Just like you, you know, you had to tell me that what we were doing was being recorded and was going to be broadcasted.
Yeah.
You can't, it's not legal if you don't.
Yeah.
I think he's mad because he got tripped up because he didn't think that anybody would ask him the questions.
Yeah.
I think he wanted to stick to the narrative that she's gone. And when that didn't happen, it threw him for a tailspin and he didn't know how to answer the questions.
Yeah.
Which is what happens when they're caught, they'll sing like a bird because they don't know how to not.
Yeah.
Well, I'm caught.
Shut up.
Right. Well, they want to mitigate the punishment.
Yeah.
Well, if I just tell the truth now, maybe it won't be so bad later.
Yeah.
So,
and that brings me to a question Chris asked Donald. What do you think should happen to the person that took her or something like that? And Don said, well, it depends on the circumstances or something like that, you know. Do you remember that?
When is there ever a good circumstance to take a child?
Yeah.
What? Do you mean if they took her to protect her from you? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Or you're trying to mitigate yourself in, well, maybe it shouldn't be such a bad punishment because it was an accident or I didn't mean to, or that bothered me as well. And when he keeps saying he put her in the car, he took her, he did this, he did that. How do you know it's not a female? How do you know? And he never changes the thought process. He never says they or them or whoever it was or that person or them people. He always says he. It's always he.
Yeah. Let's go back to that generational curse you mentioned for a moment. Some people don't understand what that is. Can you tell me what you mean by that and why you think that may be in play here?
In families sometimes, and there's several different generational curses. We're just talking about sexual abuse at this point. But if you go back and back and back in the family history and you can find the evidence, usually a male, because it's usually male, is taught their behavior by an uncle or a father or a grandfather. And then they deem it as an acceptable behavior because nobody ever says anything because of the secret. So they teach it to their son, and their son teaches it to their son, and their son teaches it to their son, and their son teaches it to their son, and so on and so forth until either A, somebody comes along and breaks that and puts the secrets out there, or B, they get caught.
Yeah.
The longer it goes on and the less it's noticed, the more confident the abuser gets on that. Well, my great, 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 great grandfather didn't get caught. My grandfather, my uncle, my uncle's brother, and now my dad, and now me. So I'm not going to get caught either.
Yeah. But or it's a family tradition, some people would say.
Yeah.
As if that makes it okay. Yeah.
As if that makes it okay.
Yeah. So you think the boys know what's been going on if it's been abused? You think they know about it?
I would think that they have their mind about it. Like, they probably see things they don't like. They probably see the difference that's being made. They probably see the small things, and they probably question it. Well, why does she get her own room? well, why does she get to have waffles and we have to have beans? You know, why does she get new shoes and we don't? You know, they're going to question those things. Yeah. But he's going to terrify, or she is going to terrify them just as well. If you say anything, you'll never get your family back. If you say anything, you'll never be accepted in this family again. You know, and how hard is that on a child to know that your parent who's supposed to love you, protect you, make sure you're safe, take care of you, tells you those things? That's terrifying.
Yeah. So do you think there's anything to the rumor about Candace and Hunter, the 15-year-old boy?
Oh, mercy. That's a whole topic in itself. I have had some discussions about that too. Everybody was like, you can't say that he was part of that. I never said he was part of that. I said he was a victim, that he's a possible victim. You're going to tell me that she can't have relationship with a 15-year-old boy? Yes, she can. If she is so mentally incapable and beat down and abused, and he's showing her attention that she desperately needs, yes, she can. She has the capabilities of having a relationship with a 15-year-old boy. She really does. Yeah. Does that make it okay? No, she's the adult. She should know better. But can it happen? Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, sure. So who do you think is guilty, and how many people do you think are guilty?
Honestly, I think they're all guilty. I think mama's guilty. I think daddy's guilty. I think grandma is very guilty. I would not assign guilt to a 15-year-old boy who's being manipulated, because how can he be guilty when he's also a victim? Yeah. So I would not assign any guilt to him. I think he needs therapy, and I think he needs help. And I think he needs to be taught that what happened is not his fault, and that he was being victimized as well.
Yeah.
By adults.
Yeah.
But I do think that grandma is very guilty. I think, you know, because, and we'll just throw her in here, but the sister is also missing.
Yes, that's very interesting. Two missing people in the same family. How does that happen? Ever?
And I read somewhere that the sister was going to take Candace's kids, her older children, and that she was going to tell on somebody. I never found out who, but she was going to tell on somebody for sexual abuse. And that's when she came up missing. Hmm. So that's what's being told back and forth. Hmm. So if that's true, then this has already happened once. Making it happen twice is not a problem.
Yeah. So do you think Summer is still alive?
I do not.
I don't think she is either. I mean, I want to be optimistic, but it's hard.
I run the mountains when I was little. I was a barefoot little girl that climbed trees and caught snakes and swam in the river and shot shotguns and chased animals and done all the things, you know. And I would not get lost from my home that I couldn't get back.
Yeah.
If I was in the mountains, I would have found my way home. I wouldn't have starved, because I know to eat berries. I would have climbed rocks and trees and everything else. You know, I could have made my way back home. And I lived in a very spacious place, the same, similar to where she lives. There was no way I was getting lost in the woods. Wasn't going to happen. So no, I don't. I held out hope for about 4 or 5 days. After that, I just don't think she is.
Yeah.
Sadly.
So why do you think this case has taken on a life of its own? Why are they tons of Facebook groups about it, tons of talk shows about it, videos? I mean, why do you think this has gotten so big?
Well, with everything that's happened over the past couple of years and everybody coming to the conclusion that child sex trafficking is an issue in this country.
A big issue.
And I think that with, you know, all these busts that's being made and all these children that's being rescued and all these people who are coming out and saying, I was a victim of child sex trafficking. I think she got kind of put into that bubble because he kept saying, somebody took her. And he's the one who kept saying, Don's the one that kept saying, they've got her. What if they took her to Mexico and she's being trafficked? You know, and those types of things. And I think that that's where it comes from, that people are just, it's the thing now to look at these cases and think, oh, it's one of those child sex trafficking cases.
Yeah.
I hate it because people don't understand the severity of the thing they're looking at. It's just the popular thing right now.
Yeah.
And that's bothersome.
Well, I think it needs to be talked about in conversations like this, just to keep the awareness out there and, you know, not to take advantage of it or anything. I just want it all to end well. And it's hard to see it ending well. And everybody involved, whether they're guilty or innocent or not, they're going to need some serious therapy for a long, long time. You know, I mean, this is bound to be very traumatic on the family. It's traumatic on us who have to, you know, worry about her and pray for her every day, you know. So I would like to see something good come of it, you know.
I would like to see, no matter the outcome, I have my own theories on that, but no matter the outcome, I would like to see more awareness with our public people. If you are in a church and a child comes to your church and you see they're not acting correctly, do something.
Yeah.
Stop being a bystander. If you see something, say something. Make an anonymous call. You don't have to tell people who you are. You don't have to be involved. But say something, anything, any little thing could make a difference in that child's life. Yeah. The next summer wells.
Yeah, there will always be a next one. I wish I could say this is the end, but that's not.
It's not.
Yeah. Well, is there anything else you want to say about either your case or your life or the summer wells case or anything I haven't given you the opportunity to say?
The only thing that I would like to say and to be in the end is you do heal. For anybody who is going through the trauma of something happening to them in a very young age in their life, you do heal. You can. Don't keep the secret. Yeah. It's not yours to keep. It's theirs to keep. You give it back to them.
Yeah.
And you do heal. You can. You can and you will. And understand that it's not your fault. It's not their fault. It can't be a child's fault. It just can't.
Yeah.
But stop keeping secrets. When the secrets are stopped being kept, this sort of thing will stop happening.
Yeah. It's very, very important to get it out there. And very
it
important.
Is.
And you could be saving others, you know. That's why I wanted to hear your story, because I know what you said. You know, a lot of women can benefit from hearing it, you know, and children perhaps. So I do thank you for coming on and being my guest. I really do. I appreciate it.
Thank you for the invitation and the chance to do it.
All right. Well, God bless you, and I wish you all the best, and have a wonderful day, okay?
You too.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye.